right, there we go. Praise the Lord. All right, we're in Galatians chapter 6. All right, let me get myself set up here. I don't know why in the world I carry around three Bibles, you know. You're only going to preach from one at a time, amen. But sometimes I just feel comfortable with them, you know.
Amen.
Amen.
A threefold cord was not soon broken.
Amen. That's what it says in Ecclesiastes, amen. All right, Galatians chapter 6, and we're going to read the first five verses. So let's stand, please. Galatians chapter 6, starting at verse number 1. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if any man think himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceiveth himself. But let every man prove his own work, then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone, and not in another. For every man shall bear his own burden. Amen. We'll be speaking on a walk restoring the man who slips. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you this morning once again for your great grace found in the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that was shed on Calvary's cross, that washed our sins away and still is pleading our righteousness before the throne. Father, we thank you for the power that you have in keeping us saved, Lord God, and that we're not keeping ourselves. Father, we thank you for the word of God that is a source of comfort and strength and direction and life and joy to us as we walk down here in this pilgrimage. Father, we pray you'd bless us this morning now to receive whatever it is you wish us to receive. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, be seated. Now, last week, the Apostle Paul there was covering how you can know a man is a spiritual man and what that would look like, speaking about the fruit of the Spirit and those nine characteristics that are mentioned there in Galatians chapter 5, at the end of the chapter there, in the fruit of the Spirit. And so now he continues on in this section where the Bible is going to be dealing with how do we handle a brother who slips, amen?
Right.
Again, now the scripture tells us there, brethren, if any man sees a man, in other words, he's just like you and me. See, he's not beneath us or below us, he's just a man, amen? If any man, face some trials, some tests, some temptations, don't we all face those?
Yeah.
Trials, tests, yeah. Temptations, amen?
That's right.
Everybody faces that. There's nobody here who's not familiar with those things. Again, the Bible says there's no temptation taking you but such as is common to man. Man is always going to be tempted, is always tempted. And when we get saved, that doesn't mean we aren't any longer being tempted. We're being tempted more now, amen, because we definitely have an enemy of our souls. Again, we used to be in this camp, but we left that camp and got in the camp of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so now he can't take our salvation, but he sure can do everything he possibly can to ruin your testimony, your life, and your ability to stand for the Lord Jesus Christ and be a light and salt in this world. And so the Bible then is covering, well, what should be done when a Christian brother has given in to temptation? He's stumbled or he's fallen, see? Again, we ought not criticize it or her. We ought not shame him. We ought not ignore him. But the Bible says to restore him. Amen? Restore her. Again, the Lord's church is a ministry of repentance, rebuke, restoration, and reconciliation. Amen? Some people just like to stop at the first two. See, but that's just a halfway measure. See, there's a purpose for repentance. There's a purpose for rebuke. It's for restoration and reconciliation. Amen? And so the scripture says that you ought to restore him. Now again, the scripture is going to show us there's a right way to approach the brother, amen, to help him, help the fallen brother, and there's a wrong way.
Right.
And the scripture is warning us this is a sensitive matter, see, on how you approach this, because there could be two casualties instead of one.
Right.
The erring brother, and also the one who's attempting to restore the brother from his fault. It's very sensitive. Now again, this business of a fault, the Bible gives a lot of latitude in what a fault is. Again, when we look at it in Genesis chapter 41, when the chief butler there was before Pharaoh, he said, "I remember my fault this day."
Yeah.
He forgot that Joseph had told him, "Make sure you tell Pharaoh I'm down here and I'm not supposed to be down here. I didn't do anything to be down here." But for 2 years, the chief butler had forgotten that. All of a sudden, the Bible said he called that a fault. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ said in Matthew chapter 18 and verse 15 that if your brother trespass against him, he said, go tell him his fault.
Yes.
Amen. So a fault can be a trespass, whatever that trespass may be. Amen. Again, the Bible mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 7, the fact that they were going to law, taking a brother before the unjust, going to law. He said, you are utterly at fault. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 7, that was a fault. And even then in 1 Peter chapter 2, 20, Peter mentioned there in the scriptures that you can be buffeted for your faults. Amen. So whatever this fault is, we know it's nothing good. Amen. Now the Bible isn't specific in this particular instance, but it's nothing good. But we will go on to find out that it is indeed a temptation. Amen. This brother has fallen to a temptation. So the Bible is giving us directions on how we then will help the brother who has slipped. Well, first of all, I want to go back. That I like that. The meeting of Jacob and Esau. Amen. Because they surely didn't leave on good terms. Amen. But man, the Lord was able to do something for them. And when they got back, man, they were able to fall on each other's neck and kiss each other. You know, that's a wonderful thing. Amen. A wonderful thing. And I think that's a good example right there of what it should be. Amen. Reaching down and helping one another. Amen.
Yes.
First of all, let the spiritual believers handle the matter. Amen. Let the spiritual believers handle the matter. Again, look at that cartoon there. Burt Cartwell is the name, but folks call me the cat, which say we stick together on this Sylvania gig. With pleasure, double pleasure. Hey, what's with the scowl, Mr. Fowler? I don't trust that character, see. A lot going on there that ought not be, we definitely wouldn't term it spiritual, amen? The Bible here says, again, let the spiritual believers handle the matter. Well, then how can we tell who is spiritual? Again, the scripture tells us that in any congregation, you can have spiritual, you can have carnal, you can have babes, amen? And so the spiritual, well, he'd already showed us that. In the very first, in the last part of chapter 5. One who is full of the Spirit, amen, having the fruits of the Spirit there. Again, what the Bible mentions of those fruits. Amen, let's just read them again. Again, the scripture says there what? But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. Again, it's to be one who's full of the Spirit and producing the fruits of the Spirit. Again, something that should be able to be discerned within the church. Amen. It's nothing that we're guessing at. We can see that. Secondly, again, it ought to be a crucified life. Amen.
Yes.
It ought to be a crucified life, as we're telling that. A crucified life. Again, the Lord Jesus Christ said in Luke chapter 9 and verse 23, He said unto them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Again, the spiritual believer is one who is living a crucified life, a life of sacrifice and self-denial. Again, something that should be seen and shown among the congregation. Again, thirdly, does he walk in the Spirit? See, is that individual walking in the Spirit? In other words, is his talk backed up by his walk? Amen. Again, is he living his life consistently with his position in Jesus Christ? See, again, the Bible said if we are in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. It's something that we ought to be able to see. See, amen. And then fourthly, you want to be free from super spirituality. Amen. If it's a spiritual believer, then you're not going to have any bit of this super spirituality. Amen. You're not going to have this envy and this pride and this vanity, which Paul mentioned in chapter 5 and verse number 26. And let me add this also. The spiritual man or woman will first of all ask the Lord if they ought to even get involved. See, that's the first thing you do. See, because you know that it's possible that the Lord may have somebody else taking care of the situation and he doesn't need you at all. Sometimes people just assume or presume that the Lord can handle a situation without them getting involved. Well, believe me, he can handle it without you. Amen. The Lord don't need you to handle it. He might be having somebody else better equipped to handle it. So first of all, ask the Lord. Amen. Ask him. Amen. Secondly, the Bible tells us that you should approach the brother in a spirit of meekness. Amen. A spirit of meekness. Again, the scripture says, brethren, if any man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of meekness. Again, the Bible tells us that Moses was very meek. In Numbers chapter 12 and verse 3. Again, in Matthew chapter 11 and verse number 29, the Lord Jesus Christ said, come and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly. Amen. Again, the Bible tells us in Ephesians 4, 1 and 2, that we should walk worthy of the vocation wherewith we are called, with all lowliness of mind and meekness, forbearing one another in love. And again, in 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 25, the Bible said, those who oppose each other, instruct them, the Bible says, with meekness, if peradventure they might be able to recover themselves, the scripture said. So meekness. Now again, what is this meekness? Well, again, the definition of it would be, it's something that is not easily provoked. See, it's not easily provoked. In other words, that is someone who's ready to yield and not cause trouble. In other words, it's somebody not looking for a fight.
Right.
Amen. If somebody didn't have an axe to grind. Now, again, when we look at the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, who's our example, I mean, there are many times where the Lord Jesus Christ was being provoked. But he responded in meekness. Amen. He responded not looking for a fight. And wherever there was a fight, the Lord Jesus Christ didn't start it.
That's right.
He was just busy doing what God called him to do. He wasn't looking to fight and rumble and have any brawls going on. It was just those people who couldn't stand what he was saying. They were looking to have a fight.
Right.
And when they brought that to him, the Lord dealt with it.
Right.
Amen. But he wasn't out doing that. Well, again, when you go to this brother or this sister in a spirit of meekness, you can't be going with a spirit of you want to fight. You got something to prove. You know, like Moses had the rod of God in his hand, sometime we have the club of God in ours. Amen?
Amen, brother.
And, but that's not right. See, too often, it's not a spirit of meekness, but it's that spirit which says, I'm holier than thou. Amen? Or it's a spirit of harshness. Of criticism, see, of hardness. See, this is not the spirit of meekness, and it does not lead to restoration, which is the goal, is to restore this brother or this sister. Amen?
Nice.
But it can if you go in this spirit of criticism and super spirituality, it can cause despair, discouragement, and cause the brother or sister to quit. And that's not the goal. It's not to get them to quit, but it's to restore them. Now, the Bible tells us that the devil is the accuser of the brethren. And believe me, the devil's pretty good at discouraging us and giving us despair and wanting us to quit. So we don't need to be helping him out any, amen? He doesn't need our help. And that ought to not be what you're known as, amen? Thirdly, the Bible tells us that then if you want to restore this brother that slips, then that you should watch yourself. Amen. We have a warning there. The scripture says you need to consider yourself. See, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, verse 1, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. So then right away we know that this fault that is overtaking this brother is a temptation. And he's fallen to this temptation. But now the scripture gives you a warning as you go to restore this brother or sister that you ought to consider yourself. Look out. See? Look out. Because you can fall prey to temptation yourself if you approach in a spirit of pride. See, in high-handedness. Again, the Bible says, well, listen, James chapter 1, verse 13 and 14, he says, every man is tempted.
Right.
See, now we can stop right there. Amen. Isn't that a true statement?
Yes.
Every man, every woman is tempted. When he is drawn away of his own lust. The Bible said, and enticed. And lust, when it hath conceived, bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. See, every man is tempted. So you can't approach another brother or sister in the Lord as if you never have been tempted or fallen prey to temptation yourself by the lust of your own flesh. See, there's a warning there. You have to be careful because our adversary, the devil, walketh about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And if you approach this brother or sister on the high horse, I mean, the devil might go up to the Lord like he did in Job and say, well, look at there. Look how big that person down there is talking. I think there's opportunity for me to get him to curse you, God. And the Lord may give him sway because here you are walking in your own pride and self-righteousness as if you yourself never been tempted. Amen. So there's a warning there. And the spiritual person will heed that. Amen. On how you approach that brother.
Amen.
Again, fourthly, then, the Bible says that you're to bear one another's burdens. Amen. Bear one another's burdens. In verse number 2, it says, bear ye one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. Again, the Lord Jesus Christ said, what, the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister.
Amen.
And to give his life a ransom for many. Amen. Well, the Lord Jesus Christ is our example then. So we should be spending our lives not seeking to be ministered unto, but to minister. Amen. And to give our life a ransom for many. Again, the Lord Jesus Christ is indeed the true burden bearer. Amen. Isn't that what he said?
Amen.
The scripture say about him in Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 6, all we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned each and every one to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Earlier it said that he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Then later on in that same chapter, in verse 11, it speaks about that he shall bear the iniquities of many. Well, the Lord Jesus Christ is our burden bearer. Amen. So, again, we're going to take our example from him. So if the Lord bore our burdens on the cross at Calvary, and not just there, but every day, amen, the Lord is helping us. I mean, again, if we, the reason we get out of bed, we sing that song, because I know he lives. Amen. Jesus Christ lives. He's real. That's what helps me get up every morning. If the Lord wasn't real, I might be doing something else. Amen. I might be smoking something, drinking something, doing something else. If the Lord ain't real, but because he's real, I can get up every day. And I got to hope because the Lord's going to help me through the day and bear my burdens. And remember, Paul had said earlier in chapter 5, verse 13, for brethren, ye have been called unto liberty.
Yes.
Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. Well, what great example of love is that when a brother or sister have fallen, that you step alongside and help them bear his burden? Because the scripture is telling us now, whatever this fault is that overtaking them is a burden to this brother. It's a burden to this sister. And what better example of Christian love would it be for you to come alongside and help them bear that burden? Amen. Again, the Bible tells us that ye which are weak ought to, we which are strong ought to bear the burdens of those which are weak. Romans chapter 15 and verse 1. And then what did the Lord Jesus say? A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another even as I've loved you.
Yes.
By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, by your love one
Amen.
To another. Again, what better way to express our love one to another, and so that the world can see again, and truly that's how they make their determination of our discipleship, is by our love one to another. Are we truly disciples of Jesus Christ? See, how can you bear another brother's burden? Well, you can be compassionate. You can encourage the brother. You can pray for the brother. See, you can forgive the brother. Amen. You can be warm. You can be tender. You can take the Bible and show him and her the precious promises of God and how they can get victory in their life. Amen. Giving that again in the spirit of meekness. Amen. Again, you can emphasize, you can sympathize. And I think this is an important point, because, you know, we have a relationship to each other, and so often it just is based upon the sense that we've been born again and we're in the family of God. And that's a true doctrinal statement, and we ought not ever not have true doctrine. We ought not ever have truth on the Bible. Again, everything is established on the truth, and we have to preach the truth. But at some point, then, we have to exhibit the truth.
Yes.
We have to show the truth. We have to show right doctrine at some point. See, at some point, it must be real. Mm-hmm. See, my relationship to you cannot just be a scriptural relationship. See, it'll have to be personal at some point.
Yes.
Because God is a personal God. Don't we tell people, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be your personal Savior? Mm-hmm. Isn't that what we tell them?
Amen.
And that God is a personal God, and God is concerned for you in every sin, and God can help you. He knows your downfall and your uprising, as all the Bible says. Isn't that what we tell people? Mm-hmm. But then we don't live personal lives. We live sheltered lives. We don't want nobody in. You know, we just live everybody from a distance. Well, that's how the world lives. You know, now everybody living on the end of a keyboard.
Right.
You know, everything's on the smartphone. Everything's on the computer, see. Yeah. But where's the personal touch? Amen? Being personal, see. This is what the world is looking for, and this is how they will judge us as disciples of Christ. They come into our a service, they may not agree with our doctrine. They may not agree with our practice of, you know, of what we do as far as our dress and what we go entertainment and those type of things. But they can never deny our love one to another. They'll know that's different.
That's right.
And that'll make them want to know, what is it now that can bring all these different people from all these different walks of life, from all these different sins and struggles and failures, to come together and have all these different personalities? Because when we got saved, we didn't lose our personality. We are the same people. Amen. And sometimes we can get along with each other. Sometimes we got personalities where we have to stay a little farther away. Amen. Because we can rub each other the wrong way. But what can make them love one another? See, by this should all men know that you are my disciple, by love one to another. Let me read you something here in Ephesians chapter 4. And this is what, you know, the Lord is working out in his local assemblies, you know, as he's gathered us together. We've been called to be together, amen. Ephesians chapter 4, let's start. Let me just read a couple of verses here. Verse 16. But speaking the truth in love. Amen. Not just speaking the truth, but speaking in love.
Yes.
See, again, some people just throw that in. I'm going to speak the truth to you in love. But when they're talking to you, hey, it don't sound like you love me. Amen. But speak the truth in love. May grow up in him, unto him in all things, which is the head, even Christ.
Yes.
From whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, making increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Brother, it's just going to edify and build itself up in love. As that body is moving more and toward the head and being exactly what the Lord Jesus Christ is going to do, there's going to be love manifested in that body. Amen. In that body, again, it's kind of like this business of, you know, you have to be in the way and out of the way. In other words, if I want God to work in my life or work in your life, and the Lord wants me to use you, maybe it might be in this business of bearing a burden. Well, I've got to be in the way. In other words, I have to be available.
Right.
See? But at the same time, I have to be out of the way. I can't be running my agenda with this individual. I have to allow God to do what he wants to do.
Amen.
I have to be in the way, and I have to be out of the way. You have to be personable. You cannot isolate yourself. See, it's important. See, bearing one another's burdens. Fifthly, again, the scripture tells us that you need to confess your own nothingness. Amen? Confess your own nothingness. Again, verse 3. For if any man thinketh himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceiveth himself. Amen? Again, Christian means Christ first, and I-N means I am nothing. Again, what did the Lord Jesus Christ say? He said, for without me, you can do nothing. Amen?
That's right.
You can do nothing without me. Again, the Bible definitely says when God has saved us, the scripture says he chose foolish things.
Amen?
Amen? He chose weak things. He chose base things. He chose things that were despised, that no flesh should glory in his presence. Amen? Again, there's no place among God's people, his church, for super spirituality. I mean, you were despised. You were weak. You were foolish. Amen? There's no place for spiritual snobs. See? Be looking down their nose at another brother or sister. See,
right.
There's no place for spiritual pride. Again, the scripture tells us, what is it that you have not received from God? Amen?
Amen.
What is it that you have not received from God? Again, so many think that they pulled themselves up by their own bootstraps, their spiritual bootstraps, and they've become what they are now by their own work. Again, Paul says, are you foolish Galatians, having begun in the spirit, are you now made perfect in the flesh? Well, no. I mean, you got salvation. That was a gift. That was given to you. Amen. You got the blood of Jesus Christ washed your sins away. That was given to you. Amen. You got the Holy Ghost to reside in within. That was given to you. Whatever gift you have, that was given to you. Whatever church you belong, that was given to you. The Bible, before you got saved, you didn't even read the Bible. That was given to you. I mean, what is it that God didn't give you? Well, then how can you approach another brother or sister and say, well, look at here, you ain't got it right. Look at me, I got it going on. Well, no. You're nothing. Amen? And Jesus Christ has it going on. Amen? There's not one person in the local assembly who's not dependent upon the grace of God. Amen? For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Again, Paul told Timothy, he said, Timothy, be strong in the grace of Christ Jesus when you stand. It's by grace. And any other confession is a confession of self-deception. You've deceived yourself. Amen? Again, the scripture said, most men will proclaim everyone his own goodness, but a faithful man who can find. Proverbs 20 and verse 6. Amen? Confess your own nothingness. Then 6. Examine your own behavior and work. Examine your own behavior and work. Verse 4. But let every man prove his own work, and then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone, and not in another. Again, self-examination. Let every man examine his own work. The Bible says, prove your own work. The scripture says what? Study to show thyself approved unto God. See, so much going on today is trying to be approved unto each other. Measuring themselves with others, the Bible said, what Paul, the scripture says, is not a good thing to do. Measuring yourselves among yourselves, the Bible said, you are not wise. And and seeking the recommendation of others and the commending of others. You want to be commended by God. Amen? Amen. You want to be a study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You want to have self-examination. See, again, the spiritual man or woman knows when they want to approach this brother that there's a lot going on in their own life. Amen. And they know there's a lot of things that need to be cleaned up in their own closet. And so they're not going to be rushing out to jump into anybody else's closet unless the Lord actually would tell them to do such a thing. Amen. Because there's enough to keep you busy on your own life. Amen. Amen. And that's the attitude of the spiritual man. Again, the attitude of the spiritual man and spiritual woman, they're not in such a rush to get over there and get that mold out of their brother's eye, because they know there is a possibility there could be a beam in theirs. Amen. Amen.
Good.
And so you trying to take care of the beam in your eye first, and then you can see more clearly, the Bible says, to take care of the mold that's in your brother's eye.
Amen.
Amen. And again, the goal is restoration. Just like the dear brother was restored in the Corinthian church who'd fallen into this gross sin, and yet they restored him, amen, through the proper discipline only church of the church. Again, let every man prove his own work. Again, the question is, have any been restored because of the love of Christ constraining you to reach out and help that brother or sister bear their burdens? See, that's the proof right there. Can you point to anybody who is walking now in the upward way because you took some time when they had stumbled and fallen and fell prey to trial and temptation and have quit and been despaired, but because you came alongside them and helped them at that time and lift their load and their burden, now are they still going on the gospel way?
Right.
Can you prove your work?
Uh-huh.
And can you show it?
Yep.
See, then the Bible says that's real rejoicing right there. See, because you've been approved unto God and God has used you to encourage another brother or sister who had fallen or stumbled in their life, just like the Lord had done for you many times personally in your own life. You've now reached out to help another one along the way, brother, and that's real rejoicing there. Amen. You're not trying to get on anybody else's coattail and run on their ministry, but now God has been a blessing to you to be a blessing to somebody else. I guess the question would be, in this wilderness land, have you been a cold drink of water for anybody to refresh them along the way? See? 6, examine your own behavior and work. Prove yourself to yourself and not to others. And then finally, realize your own responsibility. Amen. Realize your own responsibility. Verse 5, for every man shall bear his own burden. Again, you are personally responsible for yourself to the Lord. Amen. The Bible tells us, so then every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. Romans chapter 14 and verse 12. You are responsible for yourself, to the trials you face, to your tests, your failures, your sicknesses, your infirmities, see, your weaknesses. You are responsible to bear your own burdens. Amen. Again, let me read a passage of scripture that's really been a help to me over the last several years. It's been a help, you know, to Christians all throughout the ages. Amen. And I'm sure you're familiar with it. Isaiah chapter 40. Let's turn there. We read this scripture as we're getting ready to close. Isaiah chapter 40 and verse number 27. He says, why sayest thou, O Jacob, and speakest, O Israel, my way is hid from the Lord, and my judgment is passed over from God. In other words, God can't see me now. I'm not going to get any help from the Lord. It looks like I'm done in. I've reached the end of my rope. Hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. Don't you know I'm not tired? There's nothing hid from my sight. I didn't go to sleep and miss you. Verse 6, 29. He giveth power to the faint. To them that have no might, he increases strength. Now I have a note right here beside this verse. And again, I would encourage you to do this. I have 4:13 in my bedroom. Again, I was going through some difficult times at that time. 4:13, that would have been 4 years ago, almost to the day. I'll give a few weeks. 4 years ago, I was going through some difficult time, and I picked up my Bible. I was sitting on the side of my bed, and I turned to this passage and began to read it, and the Lord spoke to me. And he said, well, he said, because I was thinking it was too much. Lord, I don't know how I can go on. Things are just rough. And he said, well, you ain't reached the end of your rope yet. He said, because I'm going to give you the strength to go on. And I noted that. And anytime the Lord really can lay a passage of scripture upon you and it is illuminated to you and it means something to you, you ought to date it. Date it in your Bible. Put a date by it. Who it is, I have different things like that all through my Bible, you know, dated and so forth and so on. Because the Lord is speaking, because again, what do we say? He is a personal God. Amen. Amen. He is a personal God, and he's personally involved in your life as much as you will let him.
Yes.
That's on you. Amen. Verse 29, he giveth power to the faint, and to them which have no might, he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. And boy, I'm definitely not a youth and a young man anymore. Amen. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. In other words, if you just wait on the Lord, you just keep doing what you know to do at the time that you're going through it, and you just keep waiting on the Lord, then he will deliver. He will give you the strength to go on. He will give you the ability to bear your own burdens. That's why there'll be no excuse. Because he said, I'll give you the strength to go through whatever it is you're going through if you will rely on me. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So again, every man shall bear his own burdens. And again, what did the Lord Jesus Christ say in Matthew chapter 11, verse 30? He said, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Amen. And so here we see these two oxen yoked together. But truly, this is not a clear picture of us being yoked up with the Lord, because the Lord is really doing 90% of all the work. Amen. We got a little bit to carry. He said, and what he says we are carrying, he said, my burden is light. I remember we sang, it was a song we sang like that, with my yoke is easy and my burden light. Amen. His burden is light. Now, is it light or not? That's the question we have to answer, right? Now, we know the answer to that question is yes in our head, but somehow it doesn't make it down to our heart, you know, where we will say, yes, Lord. Your burden is light. Amen? Your burden is light. So every man shall bear his own burden. Again, the walk restoring the man who slips. Amen. Brother Dan?